Hi friend, welcome to Meezaan TV. We are here with a new lecture of transmission, switching, and signaling. The lecture is edited by Mohsin Khan and will be delivered by software-generated voice. In this lecture we will discuss about the most important spreading techniques for wireless transmission system. Before starting the lecture, it is requested to please subscribe Meezaan TV and press the bell icon. Also view the lecture completely. Never skip a point for better understanding. Multiplexing combines signals from several sources to achieve bandwidth efficiency. The available bandwidth of a link is divided between the sources. In spread spectrum SS, we also combine signals from different sources to fit into a larger bandwidth, but our goals is security. There are two types of spreading. One is frequency, hoping, spread spectrum known as FHSS. The second is direct sequence spread spectrum known as DSSS. Spread spectrum is designed to be used in wireless applications. LANs and WANs, as we know, in wireless applications, security is the main concern. The spread spectrum is designed to provide safety from intruders and jamming. To achieve these goals, spread spectrum techniques add redundancy. They spread the original spectrum needed for each station. Spread spectrum achieves its goals through two principles. One is the bandwidth allocated to each station needs to be, by far, larger than what is needed. This allows redundancy. Second is the expanding of the original bandwidth B to the bandwidth BSS must be done by a process that is independent of the original signal. In other words, the spreading process occurs after the signal is created by the source. If the required bandwidth for each station is B, spread spectrum expands it to BSS such that is much greater than that of B bandwidth. The expanded bandwidth allows the source to wrap its message in a protective envelope for a more secure transmission. Spread spectrum achieves its goals through two principles. One is the bandwidth allocated to each station needs to be, by far, larger than what is needed. This allows redundancy. Second is the expanding of the original bandwidth BSS must be done by a process that is independent of the original signal. In other words, the spreading process occurs after the signal is created by the source. FHSS technique uses m different carrier frequencies that are modulated by the source signal. At one moment, the signal modulates one carrier frequency. At the next moment, the signal modulates another carrier frequency. Although the modulation is done using one carrier frequency at a time, m frequencies are used in the long run. The bandwidth occupied by a source after spreading is BPHSS is much greater than B. Figure shows the general layout for FHSS. A pseudorandom code generator, called pseudorandom noise, creates a bit pattern for every hopping period T. The frequency table uses the pattern to find the frequency to be used for this hopping period and passes it to the frequency synthesizer. The frequency synthesizer creates a carrier signal of that frequency, and the source signal modulates the carrier signal. Note that the pattern is pseudorandom, it is repeated after 8 hoppings. This means that at hopping period 1, the pattern is 101. The frequency selected is 700 kHz. The source signal modulates this carrier frequency. The second the random process will select another k-bit pattern and frequency accordingly. This figure shows the frequency selection process for FHSS. Suppose we have decided to have 8 hopping frequencies. Remember that this is extremely low for real applications and is just for illustration. In this case, m is 8 and k is 3. The pseudorandom code generator will create 8 different 3-bit patterns. These are mapped to 8 different frequencies in the frequency table. If there are many k-bit patterns, and the hopping period is short, a sender and receiver can have privacy. If an intruder tries to intercept the transmitted signal, she can only access a small piece of data because she does not know the spreading sequence to quickly adapt herself to the next hop. The scheme has also an anti-jamming effect. A malicious sender may be able to send noise to jam the signal for one hopping period. Randomly, but not for the whole period. The figure shows that how the goals may be achieved. If we see the first cycle, the frequencies are different. At the second cycle, a totally different frequencies are selected for hopping. If the number of hopping frequencies is m, we can multiplex m channels into one by using the same BSS bandwidth. This is possible because a station uses just one frequency in each hopping period. M-1 other frequencies can be used by other M-1 stations. In other words, M different stations can use the same BSS if an appropriate modulation technique, such as multiple FSK, is used. Since we can say that FHSS is similar to FDM, figure shows an example of 4 channels using FDM and 4 channels using FHSS. In FDM, each station uses 11 meters of the bandwidth, but the allocation is fixed. In FHSS, each station uses 11 meters of the bandwidth, but the allocation changes hop to hop. The direct sequence spread spectrum DSSS technique also expands the bandwidth of the original signal, but the process is different. In DSSS, we replace each data bit with 11 bits using a spreading code. In other words, each bit is assigned a code of 11 bits, called chips, where the chip rate is 11 times that of the data bit. In a wireless LAN, the famous Bucher sequence were used. This sequence is 11 bits and spread spectrum 11 times. We assume that the original signal and the chips in the chip generator use polar NRZ encoding. This figure shows the example of DSSS. The spreading code is 11 chips having the pattern 10110111100 in. This case, the data bits are 101. Each data bit is sorted with 11 bit spreading bits. The resulting spreading signal is shown in the last line. We can see from this example that if the required bandwidth for the spread signal is 11 times larger than the bandwidth of the original signal, the spread signal can provide privacy if the intruder does not know the code. It can also provide immunity against interference if each station uses a different code. Can we share a bandwidth in DSSS as we did in FHSS? The answer is no and yes. If we use a spreading code that spreads signals that cannot be combined and separated, we cannot share a bandwidth. For example, some wireless LANs use DSSS and the spread bandwidth cannot be shared. However, if we use a special type of sequence code that allows the combining and separating of spread signals, we can share the bandwidth. A special spreading code allows us to use DSSS in cellular telephony and share a bandwidth between several users. I think this is enough for today. In the next lecture, we will discuss about the transmission impairments and T1 lines in more detail.